It was 13 bytes long. The title is longer than the intro.
Nem az elég, hogy hány darab van, hanem hogy ez 256 Okay. Opa. Aí vai.
This was the last entry from Fridos, and now we both into Windows to run the next into Windows box.
Okay.
Please hold.
Yeah, that was important.
Istenben zöldben nézni, hogy az egy gyerekes történés. Tényleg, de volt ez. Legyen zöld. Legyen zöld.
Thank you. Nem tudod, hogy a Thank you. Se può così!
Yeah!
This is a music disc, actually.
What?
Quartet, so...
Do something.
Ringmar, sorry.
Thank you.
disco tab after the music mix in our slideshow.
I'm not afraid to die.
Yes, the Twitch, they had to miss one picture. We are sorry. 18 plus.
Thank you. Come on!
What the hell?
Thank you.
I Thank you. In the home computer boom of the late 70s, with the likes of the Apple II, you begin to see the embers of companies placing copy protection, where diskettes could not be easily copied, where publishers would push a steep price for their software, and where distribution would not yet cover many of the far reaches of the world. And this is where hackers saw it as their duty to do something about it. What they would do is they would break or crack this copy protection, so that if anybody wanted, they could just copy diskettes and share them freely. The hackers did not sell these cracked copies, and they demanded no money for the work. That would defeat the point. But in a savvy bit of self-promotion and networking, and also to further the idea of cracking software, hackers would leave their own signatures, their very own digital graffiti in a sense, by opening a software on a crack intro, usually with very cool graphics and music. But the first crack intro, or crack show, as we'll come to know them, might have been documented as far back as 1981, for the Epic's game Crush, Crumple, and Chomp for the Apple II. You eat monsters attacking it was basically Rampage before Rampage. But a notable thing about the game is when you boot it, you'll find the intro screen where it says Broken by the Pirates, September 26, 1981. It's really funny that this person has every legitimate right to call themselves the Pirates, because they were truly the first one. They were really a pioneer. But when it comes to crackers, I think one of the most iconic and beloved pioneering ones will be made for the Commodore 64. For this, we had to go to the Berlins. I say it in plural because there were two of them. Getting video games in Germany, no matter which side you were on, was the pits. The Nerds and the IBM both made their way into West Germany, but they were really, really expensive. And you could basically give up on getting the Apple II, since it was basically only sold in America. On the other hand, in West Germany, you could affordably get an Atari 8-bit, or a Commodore 64. This is really the reason why it became the folk champion in this country. But games were another matter, since even in a liberal country as in West Germany, every video game was still subject to a strict review for content, especially those that promoted violence or terrorism. For example, River Raid was famously banned in Germany because he played this plane just like destroying these oil tankers or whatever. Honestly, I get it. Germany was still just a couple of decades fresh from doing unspeakable stuff. I understand this crucial need to reprogram its own society and regard it as an incredibly important thing. That's where the Berlin Cracking Service comes in. This is the Berlin Bear, graphics made by Lord Baker. It is a crack trick that endows many of the Berlin cracking stuff like the Everest that they can use in the airport. It shows, quite literally, a flag of Berlin, or the Berlin that once was. The Berlin cracking service was West German mission. They were the first German cracking group. Jedi and Plutonium crackers would precede them by a couple months. But the success of the Berlin cracking service informed and inspired other gamers in both East and West Berlin that they could do this too. In fact, as Fredo's game, the state did not want to have. I'm not going to pretend that the crack groups in Berlin were some sort of clever anti-state subversion, or the BTS managed to break the Berlin Wall or something. But the connection these disparate groups of people have, separated by both political and physical boundaries, are really terrible, because the rulers are really profound love for something. When you love something, anything that has immense value, you want to show it and share it with other people. That's why copying is an expression of love. Copying doesn't take value away from software, but adds to it. I get the sense that everybody who has ever dabbled in cracking or copying games, or has become a part of the devil scene, carries with them a bit of that spirit that helps Eastern and Western German students. And the way they think about the creative competitor and gaming scene will outlive even the state that tried to restrict them. All hackers, crackers, and devil seeners, wherever they may live, are citizens of Berlin. And therefore, as a devil seener, I take pride in the words, Ich bin ein Berliner! Berlin Cracking Service, Jedi, Plutonium Crackers, Flash Cracking Group, and all other cracking groups of Berlin, we salute you!
Thank you. Thank you.
our setup because it's run on lasers. More than 300 visitors of Punk Supply Telescope. Give a big hand to you. Really. Thank you guys for coming. And even by the time of building up this, I don't know, plastic sheet which we hold in the smoke committee, just a reminder to the stream watchers that you are still able to buy Function e-ticket if you would like to, you know, vote remotely or just supporting the party. Anyway, we really appreciate all of your efforts, and if you would like to buy a ticket, you are still able to do that. So,
Thank you very much.
I just put you off on the street set looking at you, man.
Yeah.